Good afternoon. I'm John Walsh, one of the participants in this series, and I've got the privilege of introducing Femke Diercks to you. Femke Diercks studied art history at the University of Groningen and also at Rome in the Art Historical Institute there, the Dutch Art Historical Institute, and she's taught at the University of Amsterdam and in the program at Emerson College in the Netherlands. Her career in curatorial work started with internships at the Amsterdam Historical Museum and at the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem. She worked as a curator at the Lakenhal in Leiden and since 2012 at the Rijksmuseum, where she is curator of ceramics and where she's working on a catalog of Delftware in the museum. She's actually part of the team that made a complete reinstallation of the Rijksmuseum's collections, ending in triumph a few years ago. And if you haven't seen, you better go see. She wrote a substantial essay for the Asia in Amsterdam catalog, as well as many articles in specialized journals. And she wrote also a brief history, as she put it, brief history of the Van Otterloo collection of paintings and decorative arts. A brief because it hadn't been going very long. It's still going. And we're the lucky ones because we have a good, healthy slice, about a third of it in the galleries upstairs, which is perfectly wonderful and a real reason why we're here talking about Dutch art today. That exhibition, Asia in Amsterdam, that she helped organize at the Rijksmuseum 2 years ago, revealed for many of us the extent of Dutch overseas involvement, 17th and 18th century trade, and to the wonderful and amazing Asian things that they brought, not just to Holland only, but to all of Europe. The Asia and Amsterdam catalog and exhibition, I have to say, were a major reason why we decided to give this lecture series here at Yale. Femke is also something of an athlete as a lecturer. She gave a marvelous lecture here last night, and this evening she's going to give a talk for a seminar on curatorial practices in Dutch and Flemish art. But today, our topic is Fragile Matters, Fascination for Ceramics in the Early Modern Period. Femke Diercks.
Thank you. Well, thank you, John, again, for that wonderful introduction and for the opportunity to speak to you all today. As John said yesterday, for those of you who were there, I tried to introduce the wider world of luxury objects that the Dutch East India and West India Company brought to the Netherlands and through the Netherlands to Europe. Today, I'd like to focus on one material specifically, and since my job at the Rijksmuseum is curator of European ceramics, you can't really be surprised that that material is ceramics. And also, I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey through the world of ceramics, starting in China and ending in Germany. So we're going to see a little bit more of the world than just the Netherlands today. So why talk about ceramics in a lecture series about Dutch art? Because when studying the Golden Age, it is perhaps easy to forget that more than just paintings were created. This lecture, if nothing else, can serve as a reminder of the wider world of material culture. Furthermore, I believe that the history of ceramics can give us an alternative view on the history of the Netherlands in a global perspective. As I said, we'll look at the role of the Dutch in the global trade in Asian porcelain, the production of earthenware imitations, and the fashioning of these products in the interior, both for the middle classes and for the European courts. And what the Dutch started in the 17th century was followed in Germany in the early 18th century with the production of the first real European porcelain. And in a way, I've brought a little treat, because in a way, this little cup that I'm holding here, it summarizes the whole story. It was found in 1977 on the shipwreck of the Vitellio that I think John mentioned in his lecture already. The Vitellio was a ship that sailed for the Amsterdam Chamber of the VOC, and it was shipwrecked in 1613 when it was attacked by two Portuguese carracks. It sunk off the coast of St. Helena, a small island halfway between the Atlantic Ocean, basically. And it remained on the bottom of the Bay of Jamestown for 364 years until it was excavated. It was excavated with a cargo that included pepper, porcelain, seashells, all kinds of luxury goods. And it has become a seminal way to study the exact kinds of objects that were brought to the Netherlands, because of course we know exactly when the ship sailed. And some of the objects from this ship were sold at auction, including this little cup. And some of the objects ended up in the collection of the Rijksmuseum. So don't worry, this is not a museum object that I'm holding here. And it summarizes the whole story of the fascination with porcelain, the trouble the Europeans went through to get it, the way that these journeys were intertwined with European politics, but also the obsession with the material, the pure translucent whiteness, and you can see it a little bit when I hold it to the light, and the cobalt blue decorations. It started a love affair that lasts till today. And this little cup also, because it was at the bottom of the ocean, it's not quite as shiny as you're used to when looking at porcelain, but in a way that means, you know, it signifies the whole story. And if you're very careful, I'm gonna give it around and you can have a feel. Here you go. Yes, I'm gonna keep talking. And then you can have a look and have a feel. The first porcelain, to create porcelain, you need two materials, betunza or porcelain stone. That gives the object translucency and hardness. The second is kaolin or porcelain clay, which gives it plasticity. Kaolin has a very high melting point of about 2,200 degrees Fahrenheit. And aided by fluxes, usually feldspar or flint, the kaolin and betunza form a kind of glass-like substance. They vitrify. So on a molecular level, the spaces are filled up and it becomes very strong and non-porous. François Xavier d'Entrecot, the first European to really study the production of porcelain, he was a Franciscan monk who worked in China and also spoke Chinese, studied the production of porcelain and gave a more poetic description. He says that kaolin is like the bones of the porcelain and petunza is the flesh. The exact ratio between these two is key. Too much of one and the clay will be difficult to mold, and too much of the other and the vessel will deform in the kiln. The first porcelain, and here we see the inside of this beautiful, beautifully decorated bowl from the Victoria and Albert Museum. The first porcelain was created in China around the 6th century AD. And these wares did not yet have the white translucent body that later porcelain will have. Rather, they were darker and often had a greenish glaze. It wasn't until the Yuan dynasty in the 13th century that white glazes and cobalt blue decorations became more common. Some scholars have seen a link between the use of cobalt oxide in China and the use of cobalt in Persia on earthenware and fritware that was produced from the 10th century AD onwards. The exact order of this interaction is still up for debate. Persian potters created fritware, a kind of stoneware, to copy Chinese porcelain. But Chinese potters in turn may have taken the use of cobalt from Persian pottery. During the Yuan dynasty, there was a lot of contact between China and the Middle East, particularly trade contacts. Now, cobalt was a transformative material. It can withstand the high temperatures of a kiln that is needed to fire the porcelain, and it allows the vessel to become a kind of canvas, a vehicle for design and for storytelling. There, however, the comparison between painting ends, because the production of porcelain was an almost industrialized process. A single piece could pass through as many as 75 hands before it was molded, fired, decorated, glazed, and fired again. This process was entirely standardized. One man would paint the circles, another man would paint the flowers, a third the leaves. So thinking of porcelain in a way of quality, often you have to think in a very different way than looking at, for instance, prints or paintings. This division of labor was possible because during the Yuan dynasty, one city in particular grew out to be the porcelain center in China. Jingdezhen in the Yangtze province was located very favorably. It was close to the largest repository of Kaolin clay, near forests that could provide wood for the kilns, and near a river that accommodated the transport of both wares both to Beijing, to the imperial court, and to the coasts for export. At the end of the 13th century, a special bureau was established in Jingdezhen that oversaw the production of imperial porcelain, all the porcelain that was used at the Chinese court. Chinese emperors used porcelain to distinguish themselves from their predecessors and as a sign of taste and influence. Some emperors ordered vast amounts of porcelain. Others requested especially large or difficult to make objects to show that they could. The Porcelain Bureau organized the workflow in the imperial kiln and was responsible for the quality control. However, the imperial kiln was not the only kiln in Jingdezhen, and certainly not the only factory. The city was littered with smaller factories that produced Chinese for the Chinese domestic market as well as for the export market. The very idea that in Jingdezhen thousands of pieces of porcelain were produced every day must have seemed unbelievable to the first Europeans who saw it. Before the establishment of direct trade routes, porcelain entered Europe little by little through Islamic trade and diplomatic channels. The earliest documented piece of porcelain in Europe is the so-called Garnière Fonthill vase that we see here, that is now in the National Museum in Ireland, so in Dublin. It was made in Jingdezhen around 1350, and it has a beautiful greenish hue and applied ornaments around the base. It was at once part of the collection of Louis the Great of Hungary, whose coat of arms is included in the gold mount that it was given to turn it into a ewer. The mount was removed in the 19th century, but we still have a drawing that shows it. The mount, made of gold and inlaid with all kinds of precious stones, emphasized the appreciation for and the rarity of the porcelain. It also literally framed the object. It transformed its function, making a European object out of a Chinese one. It is not known from who Louis obtained the vase, but it is likely that it was a diplomatic gift, maybe from the Near East. The vase has had an illustrious provenance. It passed through the hands of European kings, courtiers, and imported collectors, from the Grand Duke du Berry and the Grand Dauphin to William Beckford of Fonthill Abbey. That's where the name comes from. This provenance indicates that in the late Middle Ages and Renaissance, porcelain played an important role in the world of princely collectors. The porcelain was thus associated with exclusivity, with possession and power. This meaning was transferred also to early depictions of it, such as the Feast of the Gods by Titian and Bellini, made for Alfonso d'Este, Duke de Ferrara, for his alabaster chamber. And we see here some of the gods holding these beautiful Ming vessels. The relation of these rulers with porcelain was a passive one, however. The porcelain was given to them, as usually as diplomatic gifts, but they did not actively seek to procure it in China. This picture started to shift slightly when the Portuguese first set foot on Chinese soil around 1516. After the foundation of a trading post in Macau, their ships brought larger and larger quantities of porcelain back to Europe. These, however, were still largely special commissions. Like this ewer on your left, with the emblem of King Manuel I of Portugal on it. The real commodification of porcelain did not start until the Dutch got involved in the trade with Asia. The first porcelain sold in the Netherlands actually came from captured Portuguese ships, the San Iago in 1602 and the Santa Catarina in 1603, and it showed the enormous commercial potential of porcelain. The type of porcelain typically available to the Dutch and also to the Portuguese was kraakware, a kind of low-end Mingware characterized by the trapezium-shaped panels and the decorations. So you can see those... Well, I can't point at them, but you can see them on the screen. The term kraak is actually a bit of a mystery. It is assumed to have been a Dutch corruption, and bear with me, a Dutch corruption of the Portuguese name of a Chinese ship, a karak. However, some have thought that the etymology is much simpler, and it comes from the Dutch word kraken, which means to crack or to break, referring to the fragility of the material. How quickly porcelain was disseminated through different layers of society in the Netherlands becomes clear when we look at this anonymous painting, showing a certainly well-to-do, but not extremely rich family that had no fewer than 35 pieces of kraakware on the wainscoting. And some of you may remember this image because I showed it yesterday as well. But it's just, it's such a wonderful seminal picture to get this, the idea of the vast amount of porcelain that was available very early in the Netherlands into your mind, really. By increasing the volume and lowering the price, the VOC made porcelain available to a much larger section of society. So much so that, and again, I've told you this quote already, in 1611, the Amsterdam chronicler Pontanus write that it is even in common use among relatively simple people. This situation was unique to the Netherlands. The material, porcelain, was able to retain its exclusive status while at the same time becoming a consumer good, a commodity, perhaps a proto-bourgeois status symbol. In the Netherlands, porcelain first gains this in-between status as a luxury commodity. Confirming Pontanus's quote is not easy. Our sources in this are limited. Paintings give a distorted view of the interior. They were adjusted to what the painter was trying to show, not the actual interior. Cesspits only give us a view of what did not survive. Anne McCann's recently used the archives of the Amsterdam City Orphanage Chamber, the Amsterdam Orphanage Chamber, for an interesting study into the dissemination of luxury goods in different layers of society. The archives contain documents pertaining to the inheritances of Amsterdam orphans. And even though her research focuses on the 18th century, the numbers are telling. And if we look at the screen, we see that almost 40% of the 900 inventory studied contain porcelain, while only 70% actually has a bed, and only 60% of the inventories has a closet. More households, furthermore, had porcelain than had paintings, about 25%. And also very telling is because she made a distinction between Chinese and Japanese porcelain. And of course, this is always difficult because the person actually making the inventory may not have had very intimate knowledge of these materials. But where it was mentioned, she made a distinction. And you can see how much rarer Japanese porcelain was in the Netherlands in this period. That was really a collector's item, while Chinese porcelain was becoming an almost normal commodity. The VOC was very aware of the risk of flooding the European market for porcelain. Governor General von Diemen writes in 1638, and I quote, "As Europe begins to get crammed with common porcelain, we shall, after this, curtail the assortment of the same and order, according to the demand, more exquisite and fine assortments," unquote. The fineness of porcelain was thus very important, and it was determined certainly by the type of decoration, but also by the quality of the actual clay body. Because even though the porcelain that the Chinese made for the Europeans for export was nowhere near as fine as that of the imperial production, there were significant differences in quality, and discerning Dutch collectors were keenly aware of this. On the left, we see quite a simple kraak piece with quite a big firing flaw in the middle. I don't know if you can see that black stripe on the left. That's clearly something that happens in the kiln because the glaze has actually gone into the kraak, but it was still sold. On the right, we see a much more pristine piece that clearly would have been much more valuable. This Dutch emblem shows a man testing a piece of porcelain by sounding it and looking at it. The moral of the story is that you can judge a man by the sound he makes or what he speaks. The finer assortments of porcelain were not only embraced by collectors, but also by the highest echelons of society, including the stadtholder's family. The Netherlands were a republic, ruled by the States General, but the highest executive power was held by the stadtholder. Prince of Orange, Frederick Henry, who had taken over the stadtholdership from his half-brother Maurits in 1621, had explicit dynastic ambitions. And this is a little strange, because the stadtholdership officially was not hereditary. However, the House of Orange keeps trying to make it that way, and they actually, I mean, throughout the 17th century, more or less succeed in that. So it's one of those beautiful quirks of history, I would say. So Frederick Henry and Amalia actively try to create a court culture in the Netherlands. Their architectural and cultural commissions were intended to aid a message of dynastic significance of the House of Orange. Asian luxury goods in general, and porcelain in particular, were became an essential part of this message. The modes of display of porcelain they championed became a kind of signature of the House of Orange. By 1673, Amalia had a collection consisting of about 1,200 pieces of porcelain that were displayed in a very deliberate way, both in large galleries and in intimate quarters of the Stadthouderlijk Kwartier in The Hague. One gallery was decorated with special shelves for ceramics that were painted in red and gold, that would have looked beautiful with the blue and white of the porcelain, of course. Another smaller cabinet was lined with Japanese lacquer, so the entire walls were kind of made out of Japanese lacquer. And the ceiling was painted blue, orange, yellow, and gold, the dynastic colors of the House of Orange. And that entire cabinet was filled with porcelain. Amalia had inherited some porcelain from Louise de Coligny, the wife of Stadtholder William the Silent. Other pieces had been diplomatic gifts from the VOC, a sign actually of her informal political power that the VOC would so explicitly donate to her. And her way of displaying porcelain became a kind of export product in and of itself. On this slide we see a candy and some pieces of Chinese and Japanese porcelain that are all mentioned in the inventories of Amalia. Not these actual pieces, but the shapes are described very specifically. And again, the Japanese porcelain is particularly interesting because that really became the way for collectors to set themselves apart. And of course, so that was what Amalia was collecting. After Frederick Henry's death, Amalia ordered the decorations of the Oranjezaal in Huis ten Bosch, a tribute to her husband's reign. The Oranjezaal includes paintings by preeminent Dutch and Flemish painters. The overall iconographical program was created by Jacob van Kampen, who was also responsible for the procession of gifts from East and West. And by including Japanese armors, Brazilian feather shields, Indian shells, and Chinese porcelain in the accolades brought to her husband, Amalia not only connected Frederick Henry to the tradition of princely cabinets of curiosity, she also incorporated the global reach of the VOC and the WIC, the Dutch East and West India Company, into her own dynastic message. This use of and displaying of exotic goods was continued by her daughters. And here we see a triple portrait of the stadtholder posthumously and his family, ordered by Amalia for Huis ten Bosch. Frederick Henry and Amalia used the marriages of their children to secure their place among the monarchs of Europe. William, and I'm going to see again if this is doing something now. I'm afraid it's not. Well, the names are there. So William II, in the middle, married Mary Stuart, and we'll come back to the English connection a little bit later. Louisa Henrietta married Frederick William of Brandenburg. Albertina Agnes married William Frederick of Nassau-Dietz, who became the Stadtholder of Friesland. Henriette Catharina was to marry Georg II of Anhalt-Dessau. And Maria, lastly, married Louis Henry Maurits of Van Paltz-Simmern. So all the girls, most of the girls ended up in Germany. And all the girls inherited porcelain from their mother. And they all built so-called Dutch palaces that were filled with decorative displays of porcelain. And it was used as a sign to show their connection with the House of Orange. Under Louise Henriette, the first porcelain display in Germany was installed in Oranienburg, near Berlin, around 1662. She used the existing collection of the Hohenzollern family, but also incorporated her own displays. Like her mother, her porcelain cabinet was gilded, and she had very particular wishes about that. She wrote to her husband's finance minister, and I quote, "Take care that that a good gilder gilds my porcelain cabinet, for the other was worthless," unquote. Albertina Achnes, who moved to Friesland after her marriage, created a cabinet with Chinese lacquered walls, very similar to her mother's, and filled it with porcelain. Her display actually was moved to the Rijksmuseum and is on view there now. Henriette Catharina asserted her ties with the House of Orange in Dessau. She decorated her newly built palace Oranienbaum with porcelain as well as Delftware. Some pieces came from her mother's collections, others were sent to her from the Netherlands. Besides the decorations of galleries and cabinets, the Orange Princesses started another trend, more or less, in the decoration and use of summer kitchens and grottos. The sweets served in these kitchens were made by the princesses themselves, much like Marie Antoinette would later do at La Meaux. The consumption of these homemade noble sweets was intimately connected to the luxuries from East and West, like sugar, tea, and candied oranges. And here we see an extraordinary painting, and I apologize for the bad quality but of the slide, but it's just such a wonderful painting that I wanted to show it to you anyway. Because here we see Henriette Catharina and her daughters taking tea and intensely looking and smelling the tea. You can really sense that this was something special happening still at this moment in time. Now, the tradition that was started by the Orange... The tradition that was started by the Orange Princesses was followed by other German princes, including Louise Henriette's son, Friedrich, who took particular care of the porcelain displays in his remodeling of Oranienburg and Charlottenburg palaces, both near Berlin. The work on these palaces signifies his link to the House of Orange, but the porcelain became a more general message of power and, in his particular case, also of an ambition for colonies. Furthermore, you see the interior changing from a Baroque to an almost Rococo style. The ceiling of his porcelain cabinet at Oranienburg was even decorated with an allegorical painting showing the introduction of porcelain to Europe. The porcelain brought to Orania in the appropriate orange dress can be recognized as kraak and transitional wares, and they're actually quite distinctly painted. Interestingly enough, they're brought to her by putti and gods, not by Chinese figures, even though these did figure in the decorations of, for instance, Charlottenburg. Meanwhile, in the Netherlands, Amalia's tradition was carried on by her grandson's wife, Mary. Mary was an English princess who had married Stadtholder William III in 1677, after he had become Stadtholder in 1672, after the so-called disaster year for the Netherlands. In 1689, they became King and Queen of England during the Glorious Revolution. And Amalia's influence was already visible in England, for instance in the so-called Dutch banqueting room at Tart Hall, that was remodeled with porcelain by Alethea Howard, Countess of Arundel. Mary herself combined her love for porcelain with the patronage of Delft earthenware factories. And this flower pyramid that we see here, with a portrait of William on the base, was commissioned by her from the Greek A factory, one of the most important Delft factories, around her death in 1694. And I call it a flower pyramid and not a tulip pyramid for a reason. The connection between tulips and earthenware is a kind of 19th century invention. The idea was that tulips were popular in the Netherlands in the 17th century, as were these flower pyramids, hence their tulip pyramids. However, what we know of Mary is that actually the kind of pyramids that she had were decorated with all kinds of flowers. She even orders her gardener to add fresh flowers to her pyramids on a weekly basis. But there were a much larger variety than just tulips. So for future reference, flower pyramids, not tulip pyramids. Furthermore, she employed the overall design ideas of the Huguenot architect Daniel Marot, who worked for them both in the Netherlands and in England, and who is often credited with the invention of the Baroque wall decorations with porcelain. And indeed, his print series was of great importance to the spread of this fashion. However, as we have seen now, the seeds of this decorative scheme were already sown two generations earlier by Amalia. Of course, the whole connection between William and Mary and Marot is kind of ironic. Marot was a Huguenot that had been trained at the court of Louis XIV, had to flee after the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, ended up in the Netherlands, and despite the fact that William III's entire political career was based on fighting Louis XIV, he couldn't help but adopt a lot of his decorative ideas. Versailles was already so important that even William couldn't ignore it. Anyway, this dual use of porcelain and Delftware brings us to the material itself. The European fascination with porcelain was, at least in part, born out of the fact that its material was so mysterious to the Europeans. They didn't understand how it was made, and it's almost difficult to imagine today to find a material that you have absolutely no idea how it was made. It's like holding the iPhone 27 for all of a sudden. The fact that the Europeans didn't know how it was made didn't stop them from various myths about the production emerging. Some said it was made of seashells buried in the ground for 100 years. It was also thought to have curative properties. It was believed that porcelain would break if it came into contact with poison. Although this poem by Jan Vos shows that in the 17th century, this clearly wasn't taken too seriously anymore. The person addressed in the poem is ridiculed by it, saying that if it's so sensitive to porcelain, how come it doesn't break when you touch it? Even though it would take until the early 18th century before Europeans learned how to make true porcelain, attempts were made to imitate it. And I'd like to distinguish here between the actual creation of porcelain and attempts to imitate its appearance. The first, creating, was largely a scientific question. And these endeavors were undertaken by chemists and alchemists. It required funds, time, and thus often princely patronage. These attempts were closely connected to power and prestige. The second type, imitation, was the result of supply and demand. European potters made earthenware imitations in the slipstream of the success of porcelain. They tried to sell one commodity by copying another. And here on the slide, we see the very different build-up to cross-sections of porcelain on one side and earthenware on the other. And you can see that the porcelain body is actually completely homogeneous, while the clay body, the earthenware, is much more heterogeneous. And an extra layer of white glaze, that is the tin glaze, is necessary to actually make it white. Otherwise, the earthenware would just have the color of the brownish color of the earthenware itself, while porcelain is inherently white. This is also the easiest way to tell the difference between the two. Look for a small chip. If the chip is white on the inside, it's porcelain. If it's brown, it's Delftware. In the porcelain displays of Henriette Catharina and Mary, we already saw the success of Dutch imitations of Chinese porcelain. But the Dutch were not the first to attempt this. As early as the 10th century, Persian potters made imitations of porcelain in earthenware and fritware. To make their earthenware white, they used a glaze that was heavy in tin oxide. Via Moorish Spain, the technique reached Italy by the 15th century. The Italians used the white glaze to create a background for their istoriato scenes. This was a type of earthenware beautifully decorated with polychrome mythological scenes. In the meantime, porcelain had apparently become familiar enough for elements of it to be copied onto tinglaze earthenware. In his tractate about Maiolica, around 1550, the Italian writer Cipriano Picopasso mentions that earthenware with decorations alla porcellana are quite common and can be bought for about 2 lire. This earthenware was neither a technical nor a real visual imitation of porcelain. Rather, it evoked something of the ceramics coming from Persia as well as China, and combining it with local traditions. In the 16th century, other centers for the production of earthenware that imitated porcelain also emerged in Portugal, namely in Lisbon, Vila Nova, and Coimbra. Portuguese earthenware uses essentially the same technique as Italian maiolica, but it copies crack porcelain much more precisely, probably because there was more porcelain available in Portugal than in Italy through the direct trade routes with Asia. I'm concentrating here on Europe, but of course similar things happened in Spanish America as well. Then in the Netherlands, in the 17th century, several things happened at once. We already saw that the Dutch Republic reached a period of unprecedented economic prosperity. And porcelain played an important role in the manifestation of this. The technique of glazing earthenware reached the country via Flemish potters relocating to the Netherlands after the fall of Antwerp, an episode in the 80 Years' War. And at the same time, Chinese porcelain was brought to the Republic on a larger scale than ever before. These simultaneous events led to the production of tin-glazed earthenware in Chinese style in an unprecedented way, in a new way, and particularly on a new scale. Because technically, the production of earthenware in the Netherlands was not significantly different from that in Flanders, France, Portugal, or Italy, since Picalpasso's description a century earlier. Still, in the late 17th and early 18th centuries, both in France and Germany, earthenware factories were founded that made earthenware in a Delft style. So the association between Delftware and porcelain must have been very strong, and connection between the two must have been assumed. And the glory of porcelain rubbed off on the Delft imitations. Then what was so different in Delft? For one, the production scale. Delft became a city of potters, much like Gijón. The development and strong division of labor meant that the city was able to produce far beyond its own needs. In the 17th century, Delft had about 24,000 inhabitants. And between 1620 so here the dots are the about 9 porcelain factories there in 1620, to 1660 and 1700, the number of factories grew to 36. A larger kiln could produce about 20,000 to 30,000 objects a year. So much of the production must have been intended for the export market. And actually, the number of kilns drops a little bit after 1650, which we see here. Dutch Delftware was exported all over the Netherlands. Barges brought it to curiosity shops and annual markets in the whole republic. And here we see an image of the Noorderkerk from a description of Amsterdam at the end of the 17th century. And if we look carefully, we can see these barges bringing a lot of earthenware into the country and it being sold here at the Northern Market. But not just in the Netherlands. In the slipstream of Asian porcelain, traded by the VOC, Delftware found a global market. Shards of Delftware have been found in the Southern Netherlands, in Spain, in England, in France, in Germany, in Denmark, even in the US and in Japan. A fascinating example of how far Dutch Delftware reached is this set of 5 bulls, or mukazuke, that were used for the Japanese tea ceremony. The bulls are made in Delft around 1680, but their shape is not at all common to Delftware. Most likely, a Japanese model was sent to Delft and copied there. In this period, the Japanese had a particular liking for curiosities during the tea ceremony. And as we have seen, the Dutch had a special relationship with Japan. They were the only country to be able to trade directly in Japan. And bringing special gifts to Japanese courtiers was one of the ways that they retained this special relationship. However, the lion's share of the production was not quite as exclusive as the pieces made for the Orange Princesses or for the Japanese market. Most Delftware remained a cheaper alternative to porcelain, and we saw that also in the data that I showed you of McCann's earlier. Dutch potters were very aware of the impact of Chinese porcelain on their product, however. So much so that they marketed their earthenware as Hollands porselein, or Dutch porcelain, and it's a great marketing trick. In general, the painted decorations on Dutch Delftware are closer to Chinese porcelain than those on Italian and even on Portuguese tin-glazed earthenware. Porcelain was more readily available in the Netherlands, and its status was understood within a broader layer of society. It meant that even the decorations on inexpensive earthenware had to be more reminiscent of Chinese porcelain to be really marketable. The plate on the right, although badly damaged because it's an archaeological find, is very reminiscent of Craque porcelain. The plate on the left is painted with a much broader brush. The figures are reminiscent of Chinese transitional porcelain, but they've been painted quite hastily. Of course, painting took time, and a painter had to be paid. So the fewer decorations, the cheaper the product was. So here you can really see how that worked, that even these very relatively simple plates would have a little bit of an indication of a Chinese of Chinese porcelain, rather than being exact copies. As far as we know, no real attempts were ever made in Delft to create porcelain. This had everything to do with the cultural and economic environment in which these potters worked. They operated for an open market, where a product that could be mass-produced and marketed trumped an unattainable dream and an expensive period of testing. The exception to this rule are the Dutch imitations of Yixing teapots. Potters like Arie de Milde and Jacobus Karewe must have experimented for many years with clay compositions and kiln temperatures to be able to create a type of earthenware that was compact enough not to need a glaze. It was in a way closer to stoneware, but it was still much coarser than the Chinese wares. At the other end of the spectrum, some had not given up on the dream of creating real porcelain in Europe. In all cases, these projects were experimental, expensive, and far from commercial when they started, although the people involved must have realized their enormous potential. The first real attempts to create porcelain in Europe were made in Italy, where around 1575 a porcelain factory was founded near the Palazzo Pitti. It was supported by Duke Francesco of Tuscany, and the workshop was aided by Venetian, Lisbon, and Levantine informants. It created a product that was based on ground glass and feldspar that was not unlike Persian fritware. The factory only produced about 57 pieces that are known today. Most of them display heavy firing mistakes, emphasizing the experimental nature of the factory. It's really incredible, and almost all of them have these very very clear mistakes, but they still must have been used in diplomatic in diplomatic traffic because they were so extraordinary. The pieces display a mixture of maiolica shapes and Chinese and Raphaelesque decorations. Similar experiments were carried out in France, in Saint-Cloud, under the patronage of Philip I, Duke d'Orléans, a century later, with slightly better results and a slightly higher production, but not much more. Then, in the early 18th century, several things conspired to create the first true porcelain in Europe. A megalomaniac elector, a brilliant scientist, and a brash but intuitive alchemist found each other in a story that reads like an adventure novel. Here we see an image of the Zwinger, the Rococo palace that Augustus the Strong of Dresden built. The name Augustus has become almost synonymous with porcelain. In a letter to his minister Fleming, he admits to suffering from porcelain sickness or porzellankrankheit. And I quote, "Do you not know it is the same with oranges as it is with porcelain? Namely, that those who have one sickness or the other never believe that they have enough and always feel that they need to have more and more," unquote. The fact that he compares his sickness for oranges to his love for porcelain to his love for oranges, of course a symbol of the House of Orange, can at the very least be seen as an historic irony. Augustus imported most of his early collections of Chinese and Japanese porcelain from the Dutch Republic, because of course for Japanese porcelain the Dutch were the only sellers, and for Chinese they were the biggest sellers. He also brought through Saxon courtiers stationed in the Republic and from Dutch vendors at the Leipziger Messe, the biggest international fair in the late 17th and early 18th centuries. Furthermore, until his conversion to Catholicism in 1697, in order to be eligible for the Polish throne, Friedrich August of Saxony had been part of that Protestant axis that to which the Orange Princesses also belonged. It is not exactly clear when Augustus started collecting Asian porcelain. In the Kurfürstliche Kunstkammer, there were already several pieces of porcelain, including 20 bulls given to him by Ferdinand I of Tuscany. When he did start collecting, he did so with a vengeance. In 1715, he famously exchanged 600 soldiers, mounted infantry or dragoons, for 151 lidded Chinese vases. These vases are still known as the dragoon vases. He exchanged them with Friedrich Wilhelm I of Prussia, known as the Soldier King. And some of them actually came from the Oranienburg and Charlottenburg palaces that had been completely remodeled by Friedrich's father, who had the same name, Friedrich, as well. So there is, again, a direct link in this whole sort of European courtly world with the Dutch princesses. Simultaneously with his collecting of Asian porcelain, Augustus also wanted his own production. And in the early modern period, arts and sciences lived in much closer proximity than today. Advances in science were often made in the slipstream of alchemy. The idea that metal could be transformed or transmuted into gold had fascinated men since ancient Egypt. The study of alchemy required a lot of chemical and geological knowledge that was useful for all kinds of other fields, including porcelain making. It's no coincidence, therefore, that the secret to making porcelain, the arcanum, was also referred to as the white gold. For experiments like these, a lot of money was necessary, and they usually took place at courts. And in 1696, a geologist and mathematician by the name Eelfried Walter von Tiernhaus entered the service of Augustus. Von Tiernhaus was interested in minerals, in glass making, and in lens making, but also in melting and firing techniques. He had studied at Leiden University, had been a correspondent of Spinoza, and later worked with members of the Royal Society in London. In Dresden, he focused more and more on porcelain making, and his experiments included studying and melting of Chinese porcelain and Dutch earthenware, and testing different local clays. In the meantime, a young man by the name of Friedrich Böttger left Prussia because he had to flee on the account of fantastical claims about making gold in the back of a country apothecary. Sophie, the wife of Friedrich Wilhelm, wrote, I quote, "I pity the poor gold maker. More people are fighting over him than fought over the beautiful Helen of Troy," unquote. Böttger was captured in Saxony and locked up by Augustus. He had to show that he could make gold, which, for obvious reasons, proved difficult. And in 1704, he was put under von Tiernhaus's supervision, who involved him in his porcelain experiments. And for some reason, the collaboration worked, which was because Böttger was brash and wanted to do a lot in a short time, and von Tiernhaus was a scientist who was slowly trying to get to this problem, but somehow the intuition and the science came together and it worked. The following year, they were moved to a secret laboratory in Albrechtsburg in Meissen, very close to Dresden. And they continued experimenting with different clays and higher kiln temperatures. Von Tiernhaus had traveled to St. Cloud and to Delft to examine the available imitations. Together, they studied the composition of Delftware intensely and even tried to improve it. In 1707, Augustus put them in charge of a new ceramic manufacture, which opened the doors in 1708 and was supposed to produce, and here we have it again, Delftware oder Holländischen Porzellan. So the idea was to make Dutch porcelain, which we know was earthenware. But because they kept experimenting with the composition, it took until 1710 before any products were made in that factory. Von Tiernhaus's scientific experiments and Böttger's intuition using rich kaolin clay from the Kulditz Mountains finally led first to the development of Jaspers stoneware that was very close to the Yiching stoneware that we earlier saw that the Dutch were already able to imitate more or less. And then, finally, to the production of the first European porcelain. But when they were on the brink of the discovering, von Tiernhausen died. And in 1709, Böttger alone wrote a memorandum to the king saying that they had finally been successful. Böttger used Chinese porcelain models for much of his early stoneware and porcelain production. He made casts of Chinese objects from the royal collections, such as this Dahua figure. The casts he used were used as molds for the stoneware and porcelain figures that he then made. And because porcelain and stone were both shrink in a kiln, this explains the difference in size between the Chinese original and the Meissen copies. The following year, in 1710, the Meissen porcelain factory was officially opened. And even though it stood under the patronage of Augustus, and the elector was its biggest customer, it didn't exclusively produce for him. The factory was indeed to become a commercial enterprise. In 1710, it presented the first red stoneware on the Leipziger Easter Fair, together with earthenware imitations. It was very similar to the to the kinds of sales that we saw at the Noorderkerk earlier in the Netherlands. In 1713, they brought the first white porcelain that was stable enough to take to the fair. And interestingly enough, the way that you see that this really starts working is that the Dutch vendors for Chinese porcelain start complaining. That's really how you see the slight shift from Chinese porcelain to European porcelain happening on this intensely commercial place, this Leipziger Messe. And indeed, the connection between Chinese porcelain and Meissen remained strong, because when they finally figure out how to decorate porcelain, which was a whole nother story, because it was very difficult to do initially, because it required another firing, which of course put the objects in danger. When they finally figure that out, you can see that the decorations are still very much inspired by China. I would say not Chinese porcelain, because they are really truly chinoiserie decorations for the first time. And actually, a lot of them were based on one codex that is now kept in Leipzig, of all these small Chinese scenes. And the hundreds of painters working in Meissen would take small scenes from this codex and display them on Meissen porcelain from the 1730s. And so it's fascinating to realize that even though they were finally able to make porcelain in Europe, they're still decorating it with Chinese scenes. Because that's simply the connection that existed in the minds of people. And here the worlds of scientific recreation and commercial imitation of Asian porcelain meet again. Notice the simultaneous introduction of Meissen porcelain into the palaces of rulers and the homes of the proto bourgeoisie, as we saw with Kraak porcelain in the Netherlands a century earlier. By the 1730s, the Meissen factory had a wide network of agents and middlemen selling to the upper middle classes of Europe. German porcelain was able to claim this status as a luxury commodity because Chinese porcelain, imported by the Dutch East India Company, had paved the road. And this is how we can find a Meissen copy of a Cacquemont Turin, and a cover on stand, on a French painting by Jardin from the middle of the 18th century. Meissen became the new export porcelain. Lastly, and as a slight encore, I'd like to return to the courtly displays once more. Because what was started by Amalia von Solms also found its apex in Dresden. In 1717, Augustus bought the Holländisches Palais, I mean, what's in a name, on the opposite side of the Elbe from his ambassador to the Netherlands, Fleming, to whom he had also wrote about his porzellankrankheit. The palace was to be remodeled to hold Augustus's entire porcelain display. It was given a slanted roof and columns in the form of Chinese figures. It was also renamed the Japanese Palace. Most of the galleries in the palace were filled with Chinese and Japanese porcelain, organized by color. The design we see closer resembles the inspiration of particularly Charlottenburg Palace. The Japanese Palace was to become the epiphany of Augustus' message of power. It was part of a much bigger plan in which he showed his mastery over nature and in all his palaces in the vicinity of Dresden. The Grand Gallery was to be filled with a porcelain menagerie, a porcelain zoo, essentially. And it was to become the ultimate representation of Augustus's power and knowledge, his knowledge of the arcanum, the secret of making porcelain, and his power over the animal kingdom and nature as well. Augustus's megalomaniac plan was never finished. After his death in 1739, his son put an end to it. But the animals that were created for it, and I show you a couple here, were one of the biggest achievements of in European porcelain to date, and comparable only to the porcelain ordered by the Chinese emperors during the Yuan and Ming dynasties. And so our story comes full circle. Thank you. Are there perhaps, if there are any burning questions? Yes. So most of them are still in Dresden, so not at the Japanische Palais, but at the Schwinger now, which is the porcelain museum is based there. Some, however, were sold because in the 1920s a lot of the double animals were sold, and they ended up in collections all over the world. The Museum of Fine Arts in Boston has a number of really wonderful ones. The Rijksmuseum is lucky enough to have some. The ones that were actually made for Augustus, that are often marked with his initials AR, Augustus Rex, are the most extraordinary and also the most expensive. Later on, of course, this tradition of these very large animals became smaller and smaller until you could put them on your mantelpiece. Most of them, so the question is, what was the fate of them during World War II? Most of them were brought to safety, especially the things that were in sort of the state's collections. Of course, as we know, other collections in the rest of those suffered a lot. Yeah, these were brought to safety early enough. Yes. So the question was the kaolin sources, so the China clay sources. So for China, there was literally the mountains close to Jingzhen are still the most important source. Saxony was lucky enough to also have a natural repository of kaolin clay, although it took them a while to figure out that they actually had it. So that's one of the most important sources. And actually, for a lot of the smaller porcelain factories that were founded during the 18th century in Europe, they actually had to import the clay often from Saxony. Yes?
Thank you very much. I enjoyed your talk very much. And I wondered about the technology transfer. A couple of questions, for example, were the accumulation of raw materials the challenge? Was it the expertise in finding skilled labor? And then also, did China and Japan try to stop that technology from getting to Europe? What could you tell us about that?
So the question is about the transfer of the knowledge needed to make porcelain. So yes, all of the above. Indeed, the Chinese were not very keen on Europeans visiting these factories at all. Europeans were only let into China a little bit. Mostly, they had to wait at the coasts to be able to trade anything. It was only a few Jesuits that had a position at the Chinese court that were able to get there. Unfortunately, D'Entrecot, that I introduced, he wrote this beautiful description of how porcelain had to be made. Unfortunately, by the time his letters got to France, they had already figured it out in Germany, so it became kind of a moot point. The most important thing was to know how to use the kaolin clay. So people like von Schirnhaus had figured out that certain clays had certain properties, which of course was key, but then also to figure out the exact ratio between the different clays that was necessary, and to get the kilns to a high enough temperature was very difficult. So everything had to work together perfectly in order to be able to create a single piece of porcelain. And of course, very often, as you saw with the Medici porcelain, it was very difficult to get that right, because of course a kiln didn't have a thermometer. It wasn't easy to see how hot it was. That was all a question of trial and error and seeing how high the flames were, and testing that endlessly. So you needed all these elements to come together to be able to really create it. Thank you.